So derivation, maybe a topic that you guys will recommend. Those are the other class, maybe.
I think we did it in intermediate heat transfer, too.
Intermediate.
And I did it with Patel in intermediate fluids, and then again in viscous flow.
Okay.
I don't, couldn't recite it offhand, but.
Okay, we'll see, because today we got to go through maybe. I kind of feel this maybe a little more rigorous, maybe I'll skip this.
We're in.
Okay, we're gonna start.
I gotta put my eyeglass on, otherwise I cannot see my note here. Okay, it's ready to go now, right? Okay, so this will be the second class of turbulent flow. And for those of you coming into the second class, missed the first class, I quickly want to kind of review so everyone knows what's about. And for those of you who are here today, certainly will be a little bit more repeat, but it's a review. But let me say that this the course title now, as you're looking at this, they reassigned the course number to EGM, I think the engineering, mechanical engineering, and 6845, a section 1 turbulent flow. And for those of you who will be the first time coming here, we'll meet Tuesday, Thursday afternoon in the FEED classroom 313 from 6 to 7:15. For the class note, it should be available tomorrow, which is the 25th, as I said in the note. I think the secretary is about to get all printed now. As I said in the last class, that note is not totally my note, other than I edit through some of the material I sort of use in the class. There are certain portion of it is my own writing, certain portion of it just certainly take it out from some particular textbook, and I did give a reference to where you can find it, so it will be more convenient for you. Okay, with that, let me ask, is there any questions from the last class from anyone here? Okay, if not, let's try to do this. Let's review a little bit. As I said, the general idea of our class approach to the turbulence, I would like to stay with the engineering approach. Engineering approach is such that we'll be able to do something which is useful to engineering. By that, I mean that we'd like to be able to predict a little bit more than just focus to understand all the turbulent detail. Certainly, we are very interested in knowing as much of the turbulent we can, but you cannot just for the sake of understanding. And there, I sometimes use a word called post-dictions, that after you see all of them, then you say understand, then it's not helping engineer to design the future stuff. So we got to be able to do a little bit of prediction. So in that sense, I would like to look at the basic principle first, understand a little bit of turbulent phenomenon, and then go with the modeling and the prediction application first before we get into the very final statistical analysis, try to dig the very detail of how the turbulent behave in a certain way. I also mentioned last time that, maybe I use this again. We like to define for our class, the so-called turbulence. And of course, the definitions, if you look at the different kind of book, they all define a little bit different. But I think a basic character, they will not get away from what I said here. Essentially, turbulence must be a three-dimensional motion. Okay? When I said the three-dimensional motion, that means any instantaneous motion of a turbulent got to be three-dimensional. There is no such a two-dimensional turbulent unless you go to twilight zone and looking at those two-dimensional men can move through the wall or something like that. I don't know, you have seen some of the late movie I ever seen. But occasionally you hear people say it's a two-dimensional turbulent. It's in the sense of after taking the average. So for example, flow over a long wind section here, you say, okay, it's a two-dimensional boundary layer, which you understand is after taking an average of it. But any instantaneous motion in turbulent got to be three-dimensional, must be unsteady, must be rotational, and adding a irregular, random, stochastic, and so forth. I also last time stretched that if you're looking at the basic equations that control the fluid motions, which is Navier-Stokes equation, be it be incompressible or compressible, Navier-Stokes equation, we will come down to justify a little bit later on why the Navier-Stokes equation is still valid in turbulence. Of course, occasionally someone will question it, student or faculty sometimes even question it, so how do you know the Navier-Stokes equation is still good for turbulence? So we got to explain that one a little bit, but it will come later on. But you're looking at the Navier-Stokes equation which control the fluid motions, and you got to realize it's a nonlinear phenomenon. And nonlinear in sense, as I said, is a quasi-linear because not the highest derivative is a nonlinear. Be it so, the quasi-linear is still nonlinear, and the nonlinear phenomenon, depending on the parameter and, of course, depending on the geometry you are in, there will be a situation that the nonlinear phenomenon will become chaos. So that means that all the nonlinear phenomenon is not necessarily chaotic, but all the chaotic phenomenon is a nonlinear phenomenon. So you see, as I said, white horse is a horse, but not every horse is black or white. So it can be black, so it's become like a laminar or a deterministic motion and so forth. So realizing that. So turbulent flow in our fluid motion generally deal with, since all the realistic fluid got to be viscous. If it's a viscous, to get into the nonlinear phenomenon is a Reynolds number. So you pretty much can think Reynolds number is a control of where the turbulent comes. So your Reynolds number becomes bigger and bigger and bigger, as many of you already experienced. The instability occurs and then go into turbulent. So turbulent is, in the modern world, is a chaos phenomenon. As I say, chaos, then you have a strange attractor because you never be able to predict how the instantaneous motion of the fluid, after you set wind tunnel or something into motion, you can predict 1 hour later, at that point, motion got to be a certain way because it's a strange attractor building. Maybe in one experiment, after 1 hour, precise atomic clock, you pin it down there, fluctuation go this way, but you repeat the experiment again, exactly 1 hour later, atomic clock pin down, fluctuation go that way. You never be able to tell precisely what, and that is what the strange attractor is because you don't know where it's going to enter. Last time I mentioned only the strange attractor and chaos, I did not mention about the so-called fractal. Fractal is F-R-A-C-T-A-L, fractal. It may not exactly associate with the fractions, but somehow it always strikes me because a fractal is associated with dimensions, okay, the length, area, volume, and so forth. So since the fractal eventually ended up so-called decimal point of a dimension. So you heard of one dimension, two dimension, three dimension, but if you get into the turbulent motion, the cascade of turbulent eddy, now they say that according to the fractal study, is after the chaos happened, the fractal is going to 2.3 or 2.7 dimension of the turbulent. Okay, so in that sense, you should realize it's sort of like a fractional dimension that you are talking. So a little more detail, maybe later on you want to study about it, is essentially the area involving the turbulent as it started out a very large eddy motion, and you break it down to the next level of the motion, area seems to be reducing. If it is a truly conserved, then it is three-dimensional. You see three-dimensional. However, it doesn't reduce in a sense three-dimensional, so you are losing some fluid out, become either laminar or so forth or something. So if you're looking at the picture of that one, some people find it's like a 2.3, some people find like a 2.7. So it's not a totally three-dimensional kind of motion. So I kind of want to mention that one. That is in the making. It's a very recent one. Even though the fractals finding is in the 60s, so you may say it's 30 years old. But that is tend to be mathematical, maybe a costal measurement of so forth, has never migrated into the turbulent idea. So the people talking about turbulent is maybe only 10, 15 years old at most. Okay? So I want you to realize that. Now, what we try to do now is looking at turbulent phenomena first before we're looking at the basic derivations or the modeling. And that we have done a little bit of that one last time. We're looking at the wake that happened when the bullet passed through air that we are shooting things across here. And if you're looking at a little bit larger structure of it, outside you do have a little bit of feeling that it looks like a bullet is moving from this side to that side. But if you're looking at the small structure, such as if we put anything on here, then you really cannot tell. And that is what we said. If it is a cascade phenomenon to become a very small eddy, it tends to approach isotropic in a sense that the independent direction. Okay? And the higher the Reynolds number, the better the isotropicity of a small eddy will become. If you have a moderate Reynolds number, then it may not truly become isotropic given the small eddy of it. And that is creating a problem you lay down here, the turbulence modeling for high Reynolds number turbulent flow, then there is a modification for low Reynolds number turbulence model, is essentially try to pick up that the small eddy phenomenon is not quite isotropic. Okay, so by way of looking at the various phenomena. Last time we looked at it with a plate with a kind of an orifice open it here. You can see the flow passing by there due to the disturbance of the orifice, and then it created a disturbance. And if a Reynolds number is high enough, in this case, I don't know, they have a Reynolds number of, I'm sorry, put my head in there. If you can see, Reynolds number of 1500 based on the hole there. So it's a large enough Reynolds number, so you have a turbulent. Essentially, you see the chaos in there. If a Reynolds number is very low, like 1 or 0.5, you probably see the flow just go through the hole and the remain laminar as it goes out. Right? Now, if we're looking at wind tunnel grit turbulent flow, you begin to see initially receiving a disturbance, and before it amplifies, it takes some distance and then begin to amplify. Since all the flow after passes the screen eventually reorganize themselves, on the average sense, is still uniform flow. If it's a uniform flow, then it cannot sustain the turbulent motion, so the turbulent is dialed. So if a turbulent eddy motion slow down, then they would reverse cascade, kind of reorganize themselves to get bigger and bigger. So as you see, the structure seems to get bigger and bigger. And if you'll be able to looking at the so-called the average of the fluctuation, so that means even though we haven't detailed talking about this, which is the U square, V square, W square, on the fluctuating part of it, if you study the basic flow, you certainly know the Bernoulli quantity, which is the U squared, V squared, W squared divided by 2 is the kinetic energy. So the kinetic energy is reducing as you go downstream. And it's an experimental fact. You can see it later on. Theory will also verify that is so. So in this case, last time we also talked about not necessarily all the turbulent must cascade. The turbulent can reverse cascade. Right? So one of the reverse cascade is like this, when you have a nozzle with a Reynolds number of the fluid coming out from the pipe, is 2300, so you barely maintain the lamina inside, but once you come outside there, you can see the eddy can be very small, but eventually eddy can get bigger and bigger, and so forth. So there is a reverse cascade. One important thing I want to reiterate since the end of the class, toward the end of the last class, I mentioned all of this small eddy, I'd like you to think it's behaved like a Reynolds number one, okay? And any phenomenon that by now you experience all the flow, if I say Reynolds number one, what kind of flow would you get? You probably will tell me it's laminar flow, because if I've never seen any Reynolds number flow of one, which is a turbulent, very. I think a wake flow, like a Reynolds number five, will become turbulent. It's very, very low Reynolds now because of an inflection point, all of this building. Otherwise, the jet, parallel jet, all of this, Reynolds number got to be 30, 80, you know, boundary layer got to be 10 to the fifth, pipe got to be thousands and so forth. So if you think a Reynolds number one, normally you think it's like a laminar flow. So that means the small eddy, you're looking at it, either the fluctuating velocity or rotating velocity as a characteristic velocity, and then the size of that eddy as a characteristic length, and use that one to form a Reynolds number, should be about one when you look at the smallest turbulent eddy. Okay? So if that is the case, you're looking at this kind of eddy here, and again, I write it down here. It's not very clear. Maybe next time I'll write a little better. I write a small eddy and I call that length is L. So you have a fluctuation velocity times L divided by kinematic viscosity should be approximately equal to 1. And even you go down to the reverse cascade of an eddy size of this big, then I'll say that is still about 1. Okay. Now, the eddy size now get bigger, but your fluctuating velocity slower. Okay? So now the eddy is bigger, so the velocity is smaller, but the L is larger, but still 1. Now, if you go back to this kind of small eddy here, you're looking at that. Eddy is small, but the fluctuating velocity is higher. So no, whichever the way you're looking at, it's about Reynolds number 1. And this is not my finding. I just interpreted it that way. Actually, in 1925, the Kolmogorov already stated that should be about that. I just make it more plain this way. So to the end of the last time in the class, I mentioned that then you can view it. I kind of always want to think related to your daily phenomenon. So if you think large eddy is just like a big family, father, mother go out to deal with earning the money or the job stress that is turbulent in the society, but the baby in the house doesn't know, baby is a small eddy, so he just eat, play, be happy, and be laminar. So if you think that way, I think the phenomenon will become very clear. Okay, that was what we did last time. We quickly review after this. Now, I still want to continue looking at the turbulent phenomenon before. Yes?
So we can say that the large eddy is consist of very many small eddy.
Yes. Largest eddy, within the largest eddy, there were small eddy. But this largest eddy is evolving by itself. It is also
small eddy.
Small eddy. And the small eddy and the large eddy will interact. And later on, maybe we'll get to look at it, is large eddy tend to possess the fluctuating kinetic energy. Because small eddy don't fluctuate much. So you see the large eddy just go like this, and small eddy just go there. So you see this is where they possess the kinetic energy. Like your parent has a lot of money. Your children only get the nickel, maybe now is a dollar, you can go buy a candy bar. But look at your parents' wallet, probably $50 or $100. Some rich guy probably has a couple hundred dollars. So that means the possessed of a kinetic energy is a big eddy. A possessed of a small energy is in small eddy. Now, what the duty of small eddy is to consume. Just like a children just eat, and consume popcorn, butters, and just eat ice cream and so forth. They cause. So that means the large eddy got to keep transfer the energy to the small eddy, and where the small eddy will consume the energy. Okay, now of course you realize the energy got to conserve. Where the energy goes, so small eddy after consuming become what? Of course, if it is a children after consuming so much, you know he got to go to the toilet. Right, but in the terminal phenomenon, when it consumes, what becoming of that energy?
It become bigger eddy, more violent turbulence?
No, small eddy will consume the kinetic energy, mm-hmm. become thermal heat.
Yeah.
So that means after that, the consumption all slow down. Let's say I sneeze. Okay, it's coming out here, the turbulent there. I sneeze, I impart the energy to that fluid. So where that energy sneeze become quiet down, what happened? You say energy got to conserve, and where that kinetic energy goes, everything quiet down. You can say there is a minute temperature increase in the classroom because of that.
This is some kind of dissipation.
That's right. So dissipation will become a thermal energy. So your temperature increase a little bit. Okay? So in that sense, but that is not a very efficient mechanism. For example, you can take a cup. They say, oh, let's warm this cup of coffee. What would you do? You go to microwave oven and put something. You don't want to put your stick in there and just creating a thermal. How long would it take for you to make that coffee become very hot? Right?
No.
Because there are evaporation in there, and by the time you impart so much energy, there already some energy already escaped somewhere. So that is not very efficient of using a turbulent dissipation to heat it up some more energy in there. But indeed, it's a process, conservation of energy. You cannot destroy it. It's not disappear in the thin air. It disappear in some more energy in the thin air, all right, if you want to put it that way. Okay? So with that understanding, we have been looking at mostly wind tunnel kind of turbulent or the jet in there. But for engineer to deal with the turbulent, you got to understand the turbulent occurrence near a solid body. Okay? Because you got to deal with your automobile, your airplane, your body, your swimming hand, turbine blade, pump, everything has a wall there. So we got to looking at how the turbulent behave near the wall. Okay, so here is a picture. Again, I took it out from Van Dyck, this urban of this in there. There are a couple of floor visualization taken out from some other place. So I kind of want you to look at this. This is the flat plate, and the floor is going from this side to that side, and it is made visualized by the smoke, okay? And I put down the number here. Let me see if I can raise this Reynolds number. Reynolds number is 2 times 10 to the fourth. So you can see a flow pass through a plate is relatively laminated, very smooth. Just go right over. Now, this Reynolds number is based on the length you are. So as you go farther and farther downstream, the Reynolds number will increase. So you can looking at the second picture, this is farther downstream when they illuminate. Or if you like, with the same location, just increasing the speed, certainly you can change the Reynolds number, depending on how you like. Okay, this is the Reynolds number. I got to be careful with my head. You can see here, that is 2, and here, I think goes up to 100, so about 10 to the fifth, okay? 10 to the fifth here, you begin to see a little bit of a ripple, like a wave, okay? And that wave is called Tomein selecting wave, okay? In the parallel flow, when it's instability occurred, and that is where you are hitting a Reynolds number where the chaos begin to kind of feel that they would like to come out. Okay, so it's not quite chaos yet. So you begin to see that is growing. Now you can view this kind of thing as a wave or a rotating filament. Why I said that you can view both ways is depending on your reference frame. If you are running with a wave speed, all you see is the fluid farther away from the plate, moving a little bit faster, fluid moving closer to the wall, which is not moving. So you are moving it. So you see some part of fluid is receding you, some part of fluid is moving ahead of you, so you see a rotational motion. Okay? But if you stand still, just let everything go, then of course you see the wave go around it. So when the instability occurred or chaos occurred, if you want to view it as a fluctuating wave or a fluctuating vortex, that's fine. It depends on your reference or frame. And so is the turbulent eddy you are looking at. We take an instantaneous picture to catch the motion here. But if you move it, you see the wave too. Okay? So the rotating eddy or the wave actually interchangeable depending on your reference frame, how you view the thing here. Okay? Now, we're just going farther downstream, and you begin to see a burst occurred, and that is where chaos begin to come, and you become unpredictable where this burst is going to occur. Let me, for those technicians taking a picture here, see if you can focus on some of the line. Let me using this line, okay? Are you with me? Okay. Taking this line, and if you view this one and that one, if you think it's a vortex filament, like this is rotating, okay? Now, if you go farther downstream here, why that burst occurred, or like a chaos occurred, if you have a filament and it's moving, you are rotating like that and so forth. So looking at the filament, if it is fairly laminar, like at the beginning here, you see it's fairly straight, okay? If you looking at the farther down here, it's already instability become like this, and thinking that the vortex is rotating like that, see? Vortex is twisting, and so forth. So if I have a vortex twisted here, hit the plate, boom, it just disintegrates. Just like if some of you know how to make a smoke ring, I don't mean I encourage you to smoke, but if you can make a smoke ring and make a smoke ring and hit the wall, you see that the integration process is very chaotic, very rapid, all right? Can smoke? Go and smoke and make your mouth a little bit round like this, and then shrink your both of the thighs here like this with the jar and give it a push, and that comes out there and the smoke ring will come out. And the best way is facing upward, so the smoke ring will go straight up. So you need to practice to see chaos and the burst, and then you can see, you can generate yourself. So that kind of a burst is going to occur, and so because you don't know where this line of a vortex will occur instability, sometime here, sometime here, so the burst will come random. And the more the burst occurred, the higher the Reynolds number, the burst frequency will increase, so toward the end, you have a turbulent, okay? So that is the very basic process of a turbulent occurrence near the wall, okay? So you see that now. Okay, now I'm going to show you a little bit more detail of that to convince you that is occurring. You can see the burst is this kind of a vortex filament hit this wall here, okay? So you can see a peak here, okay? So if you study the literature, they will say it, some people using a valley and a hill, That means that the vortex filament, when they go up here, and then when they hit it, so they will be up and down, up and down. So you see, but when they are down, they will hit the wall and burst occurred. So you see this, and also see something like this. And from the side where you are looking at, this is cutaway view when the vortex is rotating, and you have a smoke here, and you shine the laser light, see it only two-dimensional, so you see the vortex filament, some of them up, some of them down, and that way. Okay? So I want you to understand how the turbulence occurs. Basically, near the wall, you do have a velocity gradient in the basic laminar flow. And as I said, if it is a uniform flow, the turbulence cannot occur, the nonlinear, because you're looking at the nonlinear term, the quasi-convective term. If you don't have a gradient, why you have any nonlinear? There's a nonlinear there, so nothing will be strange, nothing will be chaotic. So uniform flow, nothing happened. If you have a gradient there, then the nonlinear get into act. So near the, with all the boundary layer flow going away from here, very uniform, the only place the chaotic and the strange attractor is likely to happen is very close to the wall here, all right? And so they, when they become to interact there, then you see this happen. So most of the turbulence will occur near the wall. And that unfortunately, well, very fortunately, it creates such a steep gradient, so you need more power to overcome, let's say, pipe flow and so forth. Fortunately, in a sense, I mentioned, when you need a very good mixing, because the turbulence, after all, give you all this kind of mixing. When you need a good mixing, certainly you need it. You put the coffee, the cream in there, you want to mix, you create turbulence. In the human body, there is one place you need a good mixing. You certainly, as a God creates you, you don't want to have a turbulent flow in your body. Would you like to have it? Answer is yes, you like to have it in one particular place. Now, all the other places you see, they're all lamina. Even in the pulsating flow, only when your heart malfunction. Your heart is operate because it's an unsteady pulsating flow. So it's not the pipe flow going to the aortic, should be 2300. And over, you become turbulent. Pulsating flow can take a little bit larger Reynolds number based on the peak velocity. So something like 3,500 or even 4,000, you can maintain a little lamina. Because you see the blood vessel, it has a compliance. So when you push it, they can go like this, and can accommodate you. So your Reynolds number can go higher. So the normal heart in your body, think you possess a Reynolds number between 3,000 and 4,000. As your heart pump. Now, if your heart valve become malfunctioned, heart valve stiffen, or valve lose its rigidity, so become very floppy. So turbulence will occur, and that's why you need a heart operations to replace your heart, okay? But other than that one, you should have laminar flow. The only place you have a turbulent, you already say that in your breathing system here, why we have to breathe? Is that we want to interchange the oxygen and the carbon dioxide. And that, want to exchange quick, need a turbulence. So as if God made us from here to somewhere here is still lamina, but the farther the down into your lung, the more likely turbulence have because your Reynolds number increase by changing the cross-section. So by the time when they hit your lung area, really, the carbon dioxide has come out from the filter, that's turbulent. So you can appreciate turbulent or you hate it, turbulent that way. Okay, so you have seen the occurrence of that one. Let me show you another picture of an occurrence of a turbulent. This is on the flat plate. Again, you're looking from the top, and this is looking from the side. Now you're looking from the top here, this burst is occurring here, this begin to have a little bit of burst and then more burst and the turbulent become fully turbulent. Now you're looking at the, how thin this layer is when you don't have a burst, this layer is very thin, right? Now when the burst occurred, your layer probably triple for quadruple. You can see, so that once it bursts there, everything just goes out. When I say that layer is involving the turbulent, because the turbulent mixing will bring that diffusion of the smoke, so you can see it, the thickness in there, right? Let's look in at the other phenomenon. What I'm talking here is try to give you a physical picture of the turbulence. So then when we talk about turbulence modeling, you have a better idea of what is happening. OK, let's see if we can. Okay. This is another picture of smoke make a line here. And if it's laminar flow, you see it's just a very smoothly line by line. But because the turbulent burst, you can see how the phenomenon looks like. This is the superpositions of different time of boundary layer behave in the same location. So this is, you can see here. You can see sometime the fluid will be faster, sometime fluid will be slower. So it's fluctuating, can go this way, can go that way, can go that way. And you can see the magnitude of fluctuation. If you think from here to here is a velocity unit of 1, looking at the fluctuation, you are looking at from here to here or from to here, it can fluctuate almost 50%, okay?
This is a flat plate.
Yeah, this is a flat plate, the boundary layer over the flat plate, okay? However, I think maybe some of you heard me say before, when we say fluctuations in the society phenomenon, say there are fluctuation in population, there's a fluctuation in city water pipeline, fluctuation in the weather temperature, you always think fluctuation is smaller in quantity compared with the average or the mean quantity, right? We say the fluctuation currency with the exchange rate with Japan, you say, okay, like $120 Japanese yen to one US dollar, and fluctuating you maybe 1 yen or 3 yen or like this. When I say turbulent fluctuation, yes, most of the time you can think about that one, but it should not be limited. The fluctuations are always smaller than the main quantity, okay? And I give you an example. If I take my hand, looking at my hand here, I'm moving like this, okay? So I'm creating a turbulent around my hand. What is the average velocity? My hand of average velocity?
Zero.
Zero. Because here, so the mean flow is zero. What is my fluctuations? Any fluctuation is bigger than the average velocity. So you should think that in certain type of the flow, the mean flow can be smaller than fluctuation, okay? So that also go with, you may have a zero average kinetic energy, but you do have a turbulent energy there, okay? So for example, if I light a firecracker here, boom, the whole room is fluctuating, but there is no net flow, so the net flow is zero. But I have a lot of turbulence going on there, all right? So realize when we say fluctuation, it's not necessary always. Yeah. Most likely in your engineering program, you got to deal with some kind of a force flow most of the time, so you begin to think mean flow always bigger than the average flow. But it's not necessary so. Okay, by way of focusing, we want to study the turbulent phenomenon. I want to let you see a little bit more detail of that. Let's look in at this phenomenon a little bit. Okay, you should be able to see all the screen there. Maybe let me lower this. This is a flat plate here. And the flow goes from bottom up this way, and the mean profile looks like this, like that. And the mean profile plot in the log plot. Unfortunately, let me see if I can zoom this very close. Okay, this is called U+. you don't have to worry about the definition of U plus, but just say that it's a dimensionless velocity scale in this side. This is the distance of y I'm talking about here, distance of y here. But you plot in the log scale, the velocity profile looks like a parabolic shape, it looks like that kind of shape there, right? Now, this figure is to show you several things. Profile and the particular location of the visualization you're looking at, which is going to see the smoke down here, and the fluctuation magnitude here, okay? The fluctuation magnitude is on the side here. I don't know in your note I have that page or not, but if you get to see it, it'll show the magnitude there. So what you are looking at is that this is the turbulent flow, but very close to the wall, because this is very close to where the wall Y is here, about here, when I mark it green here. So you see the flow very close to this wall, and turbulence is going on here, but because of a wall confinement, the flow is kind of just mirroring. I may not have that, or maybe as a supplement, later on I'll print lots of a visualization figure, maybe in another pack, and give everybody, so you can look at it. So you see that. Now, the following sequence, I'm going to let you see the flow visualization as we move out from the wall up, and see what happens, okay? Now, what do you expect? Let's quickly see. If I go all the way out here, which is the uniform flow, then there will be no more turbulence, okay? So it will be laminar. If you are right at the wall, because of a sticky, viscous nature of the fluid, every velocity should be zero, no slipping. So no slipping, no fluctuation, so it will be also zero, that turbulent fluctuation. So in between, got to have a fluctuation. And in between the fluctuation, from a zero to zero, you always find a peak there, right? And that is where the peak fluctuation is. Where the peak fluctuation occurred, you probably can begin to guess it where the velocity gradient is the steepest, because that is where the chaos is going to be the largest, because you see the nonlinear term will be strongest in there, so it's going to fluctuate. So let's move to this side. Now, the wall now is about here. We are looking at this flow. You can see, compare with this side and that side, you see a little bit more three-dimensional wiggle going through. Near the wall, because the wall confinement is kind of go more like this. As you go up here, it begins like this. As you go up here, not only this, they also have lots of fluctuation. You see it here. So let me show you the figure here. Now you can see three-dimensionality become very strong where the flow is here. Now when you go up here, you can see the three-dimensionality is very, very strong. Okay, so you can see here is more confined like this, and go here, lots of this one, and then go down, nothing happened out in there. So let me show you, if you go out a little bit more, way out here in the Y, you see this is a very laminar-like, only a couple of plates would have, that's why we call it the wake of a turbulent boundary layer. Weak in the sense that lots of turbulence happening here. As you go out of the turbulent boundary layer, you have only weak left. Sort of equivalent to this kind of place. You see, turbulence occur very rapidly here, but here you kind of become adjacent, so they call it the weak of a turbulent, not the weak flow, okay? So now, let me put it down here. As you go farther out here, you see, nothing happened. This is way out of the turbulent wall is here, too far out, nothing is going on because the flow becomes uniform again. So with that, you should understand the turbulent occurred is where the velocity gradient you have it. So that gives you a very good rule of thumb. If you as an engineer, consulting engineer, say, gee, we got a lot of pressure loss, we have a lot of turbulent created, you're looking for where the velocity gradient is the sharpest, and that is most likely the place you will find some chaotic phenomenon is occurring. Okay, that is the one character I want you to realize. So now we have looking at the turbulent in the free boundary. That means no wall interactions, all right? Behind the wind tunnel, behind the grid, and come out of the jet into the open and so forth. We have seen the wall, how the turbulent occurred. Now, as the last we should realize is the flow pass through a curved wall here. And many of you in the intermediate flow, you learn if you have a curved wall here, then there is a favorable pressure gradient, the unfavorable pressure gradient, and the favorable pressure gradient, that means that they will accelerate you, right? So the acceleration tend to quiet you down, and the deceleration tends to, so if you are driving your car, putting the accelerator here, you kind of feel very smooth, very, very nice. When you put on the brake there, it tend to tend to wobble when you particularly put a very, very rapid brake in here. And that is almost like a fluid is happening too. And the car phenomenon is certainly is nonlinear, okay, when you put the brake in there. So you see the wobble here. So the flow, when you are get accelerating, you see relative smooth flow here, okay? Because the flow comes from this side to that side. When you are decelerating, you see things begin to pop up. Of course, for a variety of reasons, after you study viscous flow, to slow down, fluid cannot catch up, cannot recover. But in any event, in essence, you have that feeling of that deceleration, the fluid cannot catch up. So you will have a separate, which is laminar flow. However, if you have a turbulence in there, and then the momentum recovery can be much quicker because you can mixing it here. So though the fluid that in the laminar flow does not want to come with you, but you have a mixing there by imparting additional inertial force or the momentum to the fluid. So the near the wall, even though it's not a favorable pressure gradient, but due to the turbulent mixing, you'll be able to move them along. So if that is the case, you can see the turbulent. And only when you go way downstream, then you have a separation. Otherwise, a better following of the turbulent boundary layer. So you got to realize that turbulent is a good mixing. And because of good mixing in the curve flow here, the separation will go slower. And of course, many of you already know it. Particularly Ken, maybe begin play golf. You know the golf ball got to be rough. Rough is to create turbulent. If you're turbulent, velocity recovery will be better, and therefore the pressure difference between the front and rear side will be smaller, so the golf ball can go faster. And you heard me say that one of my good friends in Japan, Dr. Nakayama, using a spark method to study the flow visualization of golf ball, and he improved it, so the Japanese golf ball can go 15 to 20% farther than American golf ball, and they try to beat the American market, but the American has a good way to counter that one, say they outlaw Japanese golf ball, so it's not officially accepted, okay? So you cannot use it there. But for you play with a friend, you go and buy a couple of Japanese golf ball there, you can beat them, okay, let's play, you play your ball, I play my ball. you can go much faster. Okay, again, here's another example of a wall which is a straight and then turn an angle. It's a turbulent, again, you turn the angle, if it can catch up, then you can see the boundary layer. We'll just continue that way. Okay, I think I hit the couple of the major phenomenon in the turbulent without wall, with a wall, and what the characteristic of turbulent. And I hope you have a little bit of appreciation here. And I certainly will encourage you to take any opportunity to observe. Lots of turbulence going on there, particularly in Iowa in the winter. I really like to look at the sky, even though I was just in a small snow coat where the weather is very cold. But I always want to look at the jet passing by. You see, the jet wake is not our regular wake. Our wake always thinking that some flow pass through a body and wake in there. But the jet is piercing through atmosphere or the passing through here, leave the fluid behind. So it's not just stationary and you put it through. So it will give you a different point of a reference looking at the, all the turbulent creating. So I can see right behind the jet, you see the eddy is very small and fluctuating very high. But after jet passing by, if you focus on the same location and let the jet pass by, say 1 minute, 2 minute, 5 minute, you can see that small layer of the jet become bigger, bigger, and then you see a big puff of the fluid there. As a matter of fact, it becomes laminar flow because it's just all turbulent fluctuation die out, but the vapor is still available. Okay, so we got a cue, they got to change the tape. So we take a break for questions to ask that is the smallest eddy inside the lamina? The answer, I tend to say yes. Even though it's a kind of a qualified yes, because you know the turbulence all mixing going on there. Smallest eddy, but if you be able to jump into the smallest eddy and follow with it, I would say inside there, yes. Probably you see fairly laminar motion there. Because you can looking at this jet motion. Yeah, right? Let's see if we can zoom one very close. Let's say this dot. Right? It just come out in a pipe like a milk. Boom, break up into a tiny droplet. Into that. What would you imagine inside there? It'll probably behave like a lamina. Yeah, very close. Of course, that doesn't mean that does not move. It is moving, and if that small eddy will jump over here, you certainly feel you've been carried, like you are wrapped into some kind of a balloon inside. You don't know where it's going, but you know the whole thing is moving this way, moving that way, but the inside there you have a laminar behavior. Okay. That would take us to the definition of the turbulence and some turbulent phenomena. So now with that one, I would like to kind of move with according to our class note. I would like to go through the part one, which we try to cover a little bit of a historical aspect and then some basic derivation of our equations, all right? If you get a note, you will see there is a picture I'll be showing. It's right on the first page. Let me replace that one with a little bit bigger that I have here. This was a picture drawn by Leonardo da Vinci. He's an Italian in the 15th century, like a 14 something. Of course, certainly Leonardo da Vinci is before Newton. So before we know all the notion of fluid motion, even the three laws of motion there. But you can see this drawing isn't very similar to what we've been looking at, something like that. So it kind of strikes me, Leonardo da Vinci did observe the turbulence very carefully. Of course, at that time, he doesn't want to use turbulent terminology as such. But he drew many, many of them. As a matter of fact, I begin to so like it. Everywhere, every time I go to Washington, D.C., I go to National Art Gallery in there. There's a lot of book drawing section. I always go and remind of, is there any Leonardo da Vinci as a paperback or anything? So I collect a lot of Leonardo da Vinci's drawing, not the antique one, I cannot afford it. He has a lot of drawing, and if you look at all the drawing he has made, you certainly come with appreciation that he knows so much about the fluid. And for those of you who come from Iowa, you know Professor McConnell is an expert in studying all the fluid mechanics drawing by Leonardo da Vinci. He has a book coming out. And he is the only US member of the Leonardo da Vinci Society in Italy. And and he like, for example, Leonardo da Vinci, not necessarily turbulent, that's a fluid motions. If you have a water jet coming out here, and water jet coming out here, and both of water jet collide in the mid-air, what happened after the collision of the jet? So you see, after so many centuries before, Leonardo da Vinci knows how that behaved, because he actually observed it. He put the two jets here, it will cross, sometimes it will go down, or so forth. So he has all kind of a drawing there. I remember Professor Bacanio liked to use that one as an independent study for many students. In our group, Ken Obasi took with a jet issue from a pipe with a different hole, but the hole has a different angle in there. So the straight up, it go like this. A little bit angle, it go like this. A little bit more, it go like this. And the whole, so Leonardo da Vinci experimented with fluid a lot. So among them, he drew this one, and you can see someone translated, and I copied the English version of it here. It said the cloud scatter and torn, sand blow up from the seashore, tree and plants must be bent. You see, if you really read that sentence, it's indeed he's talking about the turbulence. You said the cloud, which is the fluid, scatter, which is cascade, got to separate into eddy. Torn, you can see it's become a little small eddy. Sand blows up from the seashore. He knows where the velocity gradient is very large, so you blow it, you lift the sand up because of velocity gradient. Different velocity gradient create aerodynamic force. You suck it up here, and his drawing show that all the sand get cloud torn. You can see here, and then the tree and the plane must bend. He must know turbulent boundary layer has a very large shear force. So when the thunderstorm come, all the tree got bend. You cannot draw a person stand still. Tree is here, and where the violent storm goes over. You see, so he knows it, and of course. And many of you perhaps heard that Leonardo da Vinci liked to write his Italian backward and reverse. So nobody can read it without a help of a mirror. Or in the modern case, you heard me say that if he writes this way, you cannot read, right? But with a modern transparency, I can make a transparency, just flip over, then I can read very easily. So. If you look at the original Leonardo da Vinci, but back in the 15th century, you cannot find a mirror so easy. Maybe you can find a piece of brass, you're shining it, and then maybe you can read secretly, steal the treasure of the Leonardo da Vinci. You probably can do that. So for that, I think I like to credit Leonardo da Vinci as pioneer, I wouldn't say the father of the turbulent flow, but the kind of pioneer in that one. Let me show his face. I don't know what he's thinking about the self-portrait, you know, Leonardo da Vinci is looking at. I don't have other figure. Actually, Leonardo da Vinci draw so many of them. From time to time, I'll show you a couple more Leonardo da Vinci figure in here. So historical speaking, I would say 15th century is where the human being began to take a notice of the turbulent phenomena. I put Leonardo da Vinci, the figure here. You see, I use the word post-dictions. That means post-dictions is a kind of new creation of the world to counter the predictions. Prediction is that you know it is going to happen this way before it happened. Post-diction is that after you see it happen, then you know it happened. So we call it post. That means that he already observed the thunder cloud, everything, and he knows it, he draw it down. So it's a post-diction. Now, after 4 centuries later in the 20th century, what we want to do different is not post-diction, we want to prediction, okay? So with that one as a kind of a challenge to us that we got to do something different. So in the class note, I did, say, 15th century Leonardo da Vinci. I want you to understand no Newton. No Newton means no differential equation, no differential calculus. So no Navier-Stokes equation, of course. So there's only algebra available, and the only the so-called mechanics theory of whatever the nature. And you can see they write it. They explain it by words. Okay, looks like this, looks like that. You have to have this. And that is very advanced already for human being at that stage. We'll be able to say, if a thunderstorm comes, this got to be this way, this got to be that way, tree got to bend, sun got to lift up. It's already quite a bit of scientific observation already. However, we got to move along into 17th century. That is where Newton, Euler, Bernoulli, D'Alembert come. Eventually, I didn't write down the Leibniz. Okay, if there is a young generation of Leibniz here, they will complain my note is incomplete. We should give a Leibniz as a critic also invented the differential equations. And you probably heard a story about the Leibniz and the Newton almost at the same time. Both of them claim they invented differential calculus, the differential equation. And so they want to settle the dispute, okay? And Newton said that the British Royal Mathematical Society to settle the dispute, okay? And you know who is the president of Royal Society of Mathematics? It's Newton. So Newton has a very tricky way of winning the recognition. So he won it, they proclaimed that Newton probably is the one inventor, but nobody knows. So with that, not that I want to demean the Newton or give him a bad character kind of a image there, but I will let you see the Newton's face. Is he thinking about the differential equations of his or Leibniz? So I thought I'll show you the face of a Newton. This is a young Newton then. You can see the Newton was 1642 to 1727, okay? Now, contemporary to Newton is Bernoulli, so I thought when you say Bernoulli, you don't want just think of one Bernoulli. Bernoulli has a relative, have an uncle, the father, and so forth. But the famous Bernoulli is Daniel Bernoulli, who wrote the hydrodynamics. Okay, that is the one mostly we refer to. Probably you haven't seen Bernoulli, so I thought I'd let you see it. That this is the Daniel Bernoulli, 1700 to 1782. Johann Bernoulli is his father, 1667 to 1748. And that. About the Bernoulli contributions, this again is a Daniel Bernoulli. Here you see the 2 degree of freedom assistant. So he is working on the vibration as well. He's very well known in the vibration area. Let me get on the history here. Okay, so what happened in terms of progress toward the turbulent predictions is that after the Newton, Euler come. I don't have an Euler picture with me here. Euler is the one and the D'Alembert to generate from ordinary differential equation to partial differential equation, okay? So Newton's time has no partial differential equation. So that's why we predict this equation as an Euler equation, okay? But how come we critique Newton to Newtonian fluid? Because Newton is working on all his fluid motion, but he is interested in the fluid motion, but doesn't know how to do it because it's so complicated. But he did say that well, looks like resistance by the fluid is proportional to velocity gradient. So he just said that, and of course, Newtonian fluid bear it out in the large order of the approximation still hold pretty true. So we call Newtonian fluid. Now, that was the 17th and 18th century. Now, into the 19th century, so it took about 100 years, we'll be able to create a viscous model of a fluid. And we call it the Navier-Stokes equations. Right? So we have a Navier-Stokes equation. So you see, it takes a human being a whole 100 years or so before we can create a mathematical model for viscous fluid. So Navier-Stokes equation, no matter how perfect it is, I want you to think in your mind, it's a model. It's a fluid model of it. We have 10 minutes to go, right? 5:30 to 6:45. Okay. I also want to mention the meantime, there is a Fourier, okay? Joseph Fourier in France working on the heat conduction and eventually also working on the in the fluid. It's about the same time as the Navier-Stokes working on it. Navier was a little bit earlier, if I remember, like 1825-26, they published it, and Stokes cleaned them up in like 1845, and then the equation becomes set. However, at that time, we already know the turbulence, but nobody knows how to create a mathematical model for turbulence. Besides, the Navier-Stokes equation never say that it cannot apply to turbulence. So Navier-Stokes equation as of today is still good for turbulence. Now, around that contemporary period, I asked around, where can I find the picture of the Navier? But somehow Navier never wanted to be painted, or of course we don't have a camera then. So the best I can show you the Navier is Louis Maurice Henry Navier, 1785 to 1836. And this is a drawing by my good friend, Dr. Nakayama, who improved the golf ball. And he is an amateur hobbyist to draw all the scientists' pictures. Everywhere he go, he will go to live historical museum and copy all of those drawings. So, he wrote a book of elemental fluid. You can see draw that. This Reynolds. That's Stokes. Stokes. That is a Prandtl. That is a von Karman. All right. Maybe you heard all those names. However, somehow I was digging the picture. Have you ever seen Laplace? If you haven't seen, maybe this is a good time to show you one. Laplace also have a very tricky eye. You can see this Laplace, 1719 to 1827. Okay, so Laplace is a skinny guy. And of course, Laplace served Napoleon. So you see in the court here, this. Laplace is very much interesting in the astrophysical phenomena, and then of course has all the probability theory done by the Laplace there. Okay, now let's move on to the 19th and 20th century, and here comes the Reynolds, okay? And of course Reynolds did the experiment by changing the viscosity and velocity. Without, you see, if you're born early, it's so nice. You do the experiment, only change a couple parameter, length, velocity, and the kinematic viscosity. Whole experiment just show that what that parameter control the phenomenon, and that is the earth-shaking, everlasting paper we got to recognize by the Reynolds, and did that. Of course, we got to critic Reynolds also proposed the averaging, the initial averaging scheme by recognize the fluctuation. You average it out, you get a mean in there, all right? Have you ever seen Reynolds? I have a better picture there, but I think this will be good enough for you to see Reynolds. Young Reynolds at the age of 24, like a Ken Carlson there. Huh? You ought to grow beer, and then you can pretend to be Reynolds. in there. You can see it shows here. Reynolds' signature is also there. Osborne Reynolds, age 24. Okay, so I cannot let you see it. I did have just one more picture. That's a Pronto. As I said, Pronto is the boss of a Harmon Schritting, and the rotor is his colleague in there. This, who is this? This is the same Reynolds when become very old.
Oh.
Okay. So, this skinny. This one, recognize?
Silk.
For, in the heat transfer class, we did show that. This is the Nussel. Nussel number, heat transfer Nussel. Nussel like the mountain climbing. Okay, that is all I want to show. Historically, so now you know it. Leonardo da Vinci, no differential equation, observed it. Newton come, started a new science. That's why we said that in the 700 years, the big contribution is Newton, Einstein. I certainly agree that Newton is great and get all of this started. So with the differential equation, you can look at all the physical phenomena much more carefully, can explain much better. Take 100 years to get to Navier-Stokes equation. Take 150 years here, we are talking about turbulence model and still incomplete. Okay, so that's a large picture of the historical development I want you to be aware of. Okay, in the next class or two or so, I'm going to go over the basic derivation of several important principles: conservation of mass, conservation of momentum. Let's be a little bit more careful with the conservation of momentum. You've got to deal with the conservation of angular momentum, then the conservation of linear momentum. If you don't do that one, you never get to Navier-Stokes equation, right? And then conservation of energy. And aside from that one, somehow we live in this world not very perfect. We got to deal fluid by fluid, substance to substance. So we got to deal equation of state. You deal with oil, there's another behavior. You deal with air, another behavior. Water, another behavior. So you got to be able to find the equation of state. With all those complete, then we'll barely be able to complete the mathematical description of a fluid motions, and among that, of course, the turbulence. So that is what I want to make sure everybody has a good foundation, even though this is the maybe last graduate course into the fluid area turbulence. But I want you to have a good foundation of it, even though you expose a different kind of derivation there. Since only about 2 minutes to go, conservation of momentum, everybody knows, come from Newton because of his three law, okay? Conservation of energy come from Joule or Helmholtz. You can name it, there are a couple of people working on it, all right? Conservation of mass. Dig up the fluid book, you probably cannot find anyone say that who started the conservation of mass, but I stretch the history a little bit. It's before Christ, about 100 BC, there is a, I think the Egyptian in the Huron, they call Huron, H-E-R-O-N. He was doing the irrigations, the planning for the water supply to the city. So he did made a statement, historical wrote it. I haven't seen the original version of it, but what I heard is say that if I pump in so much fluid, it goes into this entrance here, so much water got to come out from the other end for the city. So that means conservation of fluid. So if I want to stretch a little bit, Huron is the one. But somehow, if you're looking at all the encyclopedia of the fluid or the book, no one really talk about who made the first statement of conservation of mass. strange enough, nobody really wants to. But when you come to the conservation momentum, everyone know who to mention is a Newton or precedes a Newton is a Kepler, because the Kepler has a three laws of planet motion that induce Newton to think much more fundamental. Okay, so with that one, I think today we'll just be in the nice place to stop it. So next class, we'll go through quick derivations, and then we'll from that point on, we'll look at the turbulent derivation. Okay, so I'll stop here. All right, that's all. Lydia or Donna, thank you.